Starting off this evening's festivities with a Barkeep Brown Ale from TransCanada Brewing in Winnipeg. They describe it as having those familiar notes of roasted chocolate, espresso, and dark cherry, along with friendly, fruity aromas and a light-hearted carbonation. So today I'm going to be tearing down and looking at something that failed at work, so I brought it home. It is a Sylvania Vapor-Tight ceiling light. It's enclosed. It's designed for indoor or outdoor use. It's wet rated. You can kind of see a picture of it there. It's lengthy. It's it's about 4 feet long, or what's that, meter and 20, meter and 30, something like that. Anyways, it's a standard length of ceiling light. It's that big, pint glass for scale. So I'm not quite sure how I'm going to get it all onto my bench, but I probably won't have to, because the most interesting thing is likely going to be the ballast and or LED driver inside it. So I'll just tame down the exposure a little bit just so that we can see it while the diffusion lens is on there. But it's got these little clips around it that hold the lens on and go all the way around. Then there's these little mounts here that you can clamp it on. I think it's got some hardware with it as well. But it's got 10 of those latches all the way around it holding the lens on. So I'll just quickly pop those off. Now, normally this thing's mounted up on the ceiling. So it's mounted that way up. So when you're taking these latches off, they kind of get in the way. But fortunately, with it sitting this way up, I'm going to flip the latches out of the way and lift the lens off here. And that reveals the light with the LED strips all the way down it. Let's just bring the exposure back up again. So it is two LED strips that run the entire length of the thing. And I think you can see that there's 140 LEDs in each strip. The LED panel is held in by these two little metal clips here and two the same at the other end. And you just pop them into the center and that lifts right out. Noting another little feature, it's got two of these little straps on here, plastic straps, so that when you pop the LED panel out, it just dangles there and doesn't drop on the floor or whack in the head or whatever if you're up on a ladder working on it, which you normally would be. Inside it, it's got some mounting hardware and instructions and a little weather-resistant, waterproof gland, I guess is what the cool kids are calling them these days. So there's the little clips that you screw onto the ceiling that then just clip into that on the back. Comes with some little plugs, some little rubber bung, and couple of these hangers as well, which you can hook on there and use it to hang it from chain if you want to in a more industrial setting. And that's what this is intended for, is, you know, outdoor light industrial kind of use. So there's the more interesting end. There's the wiring end. You can see that the knockout is open there, so that's where the wiring would come in. It has this little connector here to connect it up to the mains. Black and white, hot and neutral, standard North American colors. Black is there. And this looks like it's just a little press-in, one-time use connector. Good for 6 amps at up to 600 volts. So the reason that this thing got removed at work is because it was only lighting at half brightness compared to the other one installed in the same equipment shack. It was faulty on delivery, so we just got a replacement from the manufacturer and they told me to bin this. So obviously I brought it home to take it apart. This is interesting over here. I'm not quite familiar with those. They're not Wago, they're something different. I'm not quite sure what they are. I'll examine that in a bit. But that is the DC going to the LEDs, and the two strips are just in parallel. So on the box, it talked about these being dimmable with 0 to 10 volt dimming, and I'm assuming that's what that is. We'll play with that later, I think. Let's get a close-up look at the LED driver, the ballast. So it says the input voltage can be anywhere from 120 to 277 volts AC. So it can take a leg of three-phase or standard 120 house current. Just shy of half an amp input current and 59 watts. Fairly wide range of operating temperatures. Now the output, somewhere between 24 and 40 volts at 1.2 amps. And again, 48 watts. Power factor 0.95. Aha! So it's power factor corrected. Nice. There is the input live and neutral. There is the output plus and minus volts. And the gray and purple are the dimming. V minus and V plus. So here we go. Power on. It is drawing 4.6 watts, 4.5 watts, 67 milliamps thereabouts. Current voltage is 122.5. Okay. So this is not very bright at all. So I'm going to try and throw some voltage onto these two dimming wires. Now on the box it said 0 to 10 volt dimming. So if I short that, that would be 0 volts. And I don't see any dimming happening there. Okay, maybe before we get too carried away here, we'll just see what the actual voltage on the LEDs is. Across one LED is 2.58 volts. Can you see that? And across the whole strip, it is 25.8. Okay, so there's 10 LEDs in series per, in the series strings, then those series strings are paralleled. Make sense? Sure. But that should be closer to 3 watts, or 3 volts, you would think, across an individual LED. And that sort of bears out because it is, like I said, kind of half brightness. I can stare at this thing and it's not blinding at all. So I'll put my DC power supply onto the dimming wires. Run that voltage up. There's 5 volts. There's 10 volts. It's not doing anything. Turn that off. And if I make 0 volts, yeah. So that should dim, you would expect. My guess is that there's something wrong with the dimming circuit inside that LED driver there. So this would be as good a time as any to tear that off and see if I can open it up. The ballast just held in by 2 bolts there with those screws going through the back. That works pretty well. That's the first time I've actually used that little well stick driver for anything real. It's pretty neat. So there's heat. There's the ballast, or driver, whatever you want to call it. Can I get that out of those connectors down there? I don't recognize those connectors. They're not Wiggle branded. I can't see what they are. I don't think they're reversible, though. Not easily, anyways. I have to dick around with them a little bit, otherwise I'll just cut the wires. No, they don't want to back out, so I'll just cut them short, and if I actually fix this thing, I'll replace with Wagos, because I have those kicking around here. So the ballast feels like it might be potted, but I'm going to try and get into it anyway. But it looks like it is sort of clipped together. Where's my spudgers here? Get into here. So there's little kind of crimped clips on the ends, and then other clips just along the sides holding it together. Well, there we go. And potting compound. I guess I should not have been surprised by that. I was actually expecting that. Can we get that out? Because it looks like there is sort of a plastic insulating sheet in between the sides of the container and the potting compound. Well, there we go. You hear that? Ooh. Just notice, see right there, there's a component lead that goes under a piece of the metalwork. It looks like another one up there. So it is grounded to the case. That's good from an electrical point of view. Kind of a pain in the ass for taking it apart point of view. You just zoom out so you don't get sick here. But I think if I just do that, and where's my crusty old clippers here? Yeah, use the old ones, and I'm going to clip the metalwork rather than the ground wire. I'm going to keep kind of prying on this and see if I can get this whole potted mess out of the tin and see how much more intelligence I can get out of it. I'm holding up less and less hope all the time, but you never know. I'll come back. This is boring. Okay. I've got it freed from the metalwork. There we can see the insulating sheet that wraps around it. In case you hadn't figured it out, I've given up hope of reviving this thing. But I still want to see what's going on inside it. This stuff's a little bit sticky. Just a little bit. But we'll see if I can get in there and kind of pry some of it off. It seems to want to come off in chunks. So the point of this potting compound, well, there's a couple. It's got electrically insulating properties to it. It's vibration reduction, obviously, because none of these components can vibrate in here when they're all gooped together. Oh, I'm seeing the capacitor. And keeps the weather out of it as well, because this, remember, is an outdoor rated fixture. Even though there was gasketing around the case, and the case itself was waterproof or moisture resistant. Okay, this is going to take some work. I'll come back. Well, that's the result of about half an hour chiseling, and I've kind of destroyed my spudger. I'm not sure how I'm going to clean that off my screwdriver. But, yeah, I found a few components in there. Oddly, there's a heat sink, actually two heat sinks buried underneath all that potting compound. So I'm not sure how well they actually do their job. Got a capacitor down there, transformer, another transformer inductor, some capacitors at the beginning here. What looks like a class X or class Y capacitor down there, probably. And a diode here. But chiseling and mechanically hacking away at this thing is not going to be the way forward if I want to find out what's inside there. And as I mentioned earlier, I'm kind of resigned to this thing not working. I just want to see what's in there. So I decided to see if a chemical method would help me. So this has got alcohol in it and nothing's happened there. But I did find something that will work to dissolve this stuff. You can see it kind of working already in there and dissolving a bit. Still slow, but it's easier, I guess, than chiseling. That is paint thinner. I don't know exactly what sort of paint thinner, but this is designed to work on oil paints and stuff like that. Mineral spirits, I guess, is the main component of it. Oh, yeah, you can see just a little bit of it on my hands is melting there. So, just in case this little fancy little tinfoil dish that I've created leaks. I'm going to do it in the laundry sink. And I can rinse it down. I don't know how long this is going to take or if it's even going to work. So I will probably come back to this at some point in the future. Not sure.
Later that same evening.
Okay, several hours have passed and I have been instructed to stop whatever smelly thing I'm doing and make the house more livable. So this is still as hard as it ever was. It's just taken a surface layer off. I mean, eventually this will dissolve that stuff, but I don't have that much time. Oh well, that was fun while it lasted, I guess. I understand why this stuff gets potted. It's for functional reasons. It's not, well, not only to keep us from reverse engineering it, but it is serving that purpose. So, as unsatisfying as it is, this ends. So, well, that wasn't exactly how I intended to end that video, but compromises must be made to maintain peace. So I stand by my original suggestion that it was probably the dimming circuit in that ballast or driver that was the problem, but unfortunately, as you saw, we couldn't get down to it before the experiment had to be ended. Oh well, it was fun while it lasted anyways. Thanks for watching. Comments and questions down below as usual. I'll talk to you later.